So if you want to make six figures, you can't just be talking about you want to make six figures. You hear what I'm saying to you tonight? If you do the three things I tell you to do tonight, I guarantee you, whatever it is you want to do in life, you'll be able to do. You will be able to accomplish whatever you want to academically, financially, relationally, whatever. So three things. Young man who, you know, he wanted to make a lot of money, and so he went to this guru, right? And he told the guru, you know, I want to be on the same level you are. And so the guru said, if you want to be on the same level I'm on, I'll meet you tomorrow at the beach at 4 a.m. He liked the beach. I said, I want to make money. I don't want to swim. Guru said, if you want to make money, I'll meet you tomorrow, 4 a.m. So the young man got there at 4 a.m. He all ready to rock and roll, got on the suit, should have worn shorts. The old man grabs his hand, said, how bad do you want to be successful? He said, real bad. He said, walk on out in the water. So he walks out into the water. Watch this. When he walks out into the water, it goes waist deep. So he like, this guy crazy. Adrian, he's like, I want to make money. He got me out here swimming. I didn't ask to be a lifeguard. I want to make money. He got me in. So he said, come out a little further. Walked out a little further. Then he had it right around this area, the shoulder area. So this old man crazy. He's making money, but he crazy. He said, come on out a little further. Came out a little further. It was right at his mouth. My man like, I'm about to go back in here. This guy is mine. So the old man said, I thought you said you wanted to be successful. He said, I do. He said, walk a little further. He came, dropped his head in, held him down, hold him down. My man getting scratched. Just before my man was about to pass out, he raised him up. He said, I got a question for you. Somebody answered the question for me. He said, when you were underwater, what did you want to do? Lee, I'm looking for a different word though. What's that word? He said, I wanted to breathe. He told the guy, he said, when you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe, then you'll be successful.
Yeah, 92, 93, cause we gotta be like 10. So, my man Kev White took me down to Brooklyn, USA. So, I ended up going to Brooklyn, USA on like a Thursday for a tryout. Then, we ended up going to Chicago that weekend. So, I come back from Chicago, and G ain't seen me the whole week or whatever. And during that week, they had baseball games. So when we come back from Chicago, he like, yo, where you been? Where you was at the whole week? And I was like, yo, bro, I just went to Chicago. I don't know what this is. I ain't know if it was AAU at the time. I'm like, yo, but I went to Chicago with these Brooklyn USA niggas, met these star niggas, and we played four or five games. I'm out there killing. So it's funny, the nigga got tight. So I'm like, yo, bro, what you gonna do? You down there playing baseball, being the shortstop of the year and shit. You need to get with this hoop and shit. So then, after this Brooklyn USA shit happens, he on something like, yo, when the next tryout? So now the tryout ain't for a while. But this lady from my building, her name was Cheryl. She had a daughter named Tia. So they takes me to Red Hook, to the Mickey-O. So I go there. I do my thing. Now he asked me, like, yo, you got more friends who play ball your age? I'm like, hell yeah, there's a lot of us. So now I come back from Red Hook, and I'm telling them, like, yo, son, y'all niggas gotta come. Fuck that baseball game on Saturday. come to Red Hook and we gonna hoop and we gonna do our thing. So we end up going to Red Hook. G came, all of us came. That was our age. He got right.
And ever since that day, I had a change of focus. You never know how life, how people come into your life. It's funny because one of the refs of that game, when we had shirts and skins, was Alan Griffin. And Alan Griffin told Ziggy, "Zig, I don't know who this kid is, but you better put him on your team." I mean, as you see, a little bit later down the line, Alan Griffin was the starting point guard at Robeson, and I was going to watch him play and following those footsteps.
For now, this is his first tournament. We actually playing with a team called XL. That's the Mickey O, it's Johnny and Walt. They the coaches or whatever. And then from there, that led to a holy name. That led to him playing holy name, which was CYO. Visitation, which was CYO. And then from there, he kind of just took off with the basketball shit. And it was funny because the nigga was one of the good ones in baseball. It was him and a few other niggas from his building that was elite in baseball. But I kept telling him, like, yo, bro, I'm not playing no baseball. I'm not a baseball player. We go play basketball, like, you know what I'm saying? Because I'm in the park all day, my building behind the park. His building's a little bit in the front. And there's a little more Spanish people in this building, so they fucking with the baseball shit. Heavy. And then I guess once bro got a whiff of that motherfucking basketball, his shit, he just got turned out with it and kept going. Ain't not gonna front. And he knows the truth. He wasn't even that good when he first started. He just was fast and had hand and eye coordination.
That comes from the baseball.
So that came from the baseball and football. He played football too. So he always knew how to catch. He knew how to run. He was fast. Put this in there too, G. His building was bad. So they played tag and did the bad shit. So that's what I believe led to the family shit. So you see how it all came together from, you know, being kids, just being active. I'm a salute to something major happened to where he left. And he went to stay with his mom and his grandmoms and them on the other side of Notion, on the other side, like by Notion where he's at, whatever. But I think that was the best thing because if he would have stayed here growing up, who knows where it would have turned, because they was in the shit, not like selling, because we too young doing shit like that, but just doing little 10-year-old, 9-year-old shit. We kicking in the stores and running and stealing. But instead of that, a nigga like me, I was just focused on ball. And I'm like, nah, I'm not doing that, bro. And I'm not fast, so I can't run with y'all and shit. You know what I'm saying? So he was always quick, so he was cool with the grab and dash shit.
They call it the pound, 195.
And we used to have building games too. It was they building versus my building. Then we had our man Sarge in them on Bond Street. So it used to be thick. Oh, so where his competitive nature come from, I'm gonna say it came from here because everything we did was competitive. We played building tag, building fight, building ball, everything. So everything was competitive and niggas not talking to each other after the games or nothing. Like, see niggas the ball. If we speak the ball, or if we fight, if that's what it is. So I know that's where a lot of that fire came from. And like you said, you had to have heart. Fucking with these niggas in this building, because these niggas are just crazy.
That's how I'm talking about threatening me. Make that to the fuck.
Good, you got up out of here, I'm telling
you. What's up, that ain't
right. Yeah. Wow. That's the beauty of it, though.
Ain't no beauty.
Yes, that is.
You get to leave. That's how you saying that.
No, I mean, it's obvious. You say it's different, like on it, like daily, but nah.
Daily, all day, every day. That's environments with stress.
Nah.
But it's, it is, and it's unhealthy.
A little.
They work. I just mopped them shits too, so you valid. They gotta keep this. If you want to speak to my work.
This is crazy. Oh, they got cameras in the elevator. Yeah, this is crazy. I haven't been up here. I'm lying. Last time I've been up here was to see Say and Dave and my god brother Ty, grandma's Miss Shepherd, who passed away a few years ago. But damn, memories.
Thought of that.
Not F. Damn, this bring back memories. I mean, obviously we had the regular doorknob like this, same doorknob, they must have changed it, but the memories in here, bro, it's crazy.
This one, I was a baseball player. I had just started transitioning to basketball, like right before I left, probably a few days before I left. But 9F, where it all started. I gotta put some ink on me about that, with a little saying. Word. I wish we could get up in, you know. Just to see, I remember when you're going, so when you're going, the whole thing is the big living room. It's a big, like, the little space. The two bedroom. Going, the kitchen, going a little bit, the bathroom, my bedroom, my mom's in the bedroom. Crazy, bro. The projects, bro. That's how we got out of poverty with this one. This is fire. Wow. And it's the first time I've been here since, damn, like fifth grade? I haven't walked in any of this, like, for a while. But you see how I said I was right here, and then this is my shepherd house right here. This is another place we used to be at all the time, so. Rest in peace, with Shepard, love you. A real, real, real project kid, you know, doing all of the crazy stuff, flipping, climbing stairs, jumping over the ramps. We used to play tag in the hallways, like on the opposite side, like the door used to, like, you could keep the door open and hide behind it, like so nobody would see you, and once they go through, you run out and get on your base by the window. Like, we used to do everything here, bro. That's probably why I had a little bit of bounce as a youngin' walking up and down these stairs like this. I used to do all this stuff. Slide down this, slide under right here. Like on all the art floors, you have this. So for instance, you see this right here? I don't know if you still could do it, but you should be able to open the door. Okay. Still be able to open the door. Used to get stuck right there. I'ma see if you could do it. They used to get stuck right there. You used to hide under there and hold on to this. Like, bro, the stuff that we used to do on me, I can't even see nobody. Obviously, I'm a little bit bigger and older. That was the incinerator right there. Wow. I'm doing a documentary, and I was just showing them, you know, around, and, you know. How you doing?
I'm doing okay.
You doing okay?
You want to come in?
Still looking good.
That's my jeans. Come in. How are you going to be here? Tasha, pick up that.
Pick that up, Tasha. Pick that no. up.
Yeah, like, right, always.
Hey, this is my lady.
That's right. Yeah.
This lady used to. Bring it, go to school. And he wave me the door, and I bring it to school back and forth until he graduated from sixth grade.
This is the best when you get to come back and see that.
They went to school together from first grade to sixth grade.
Yeah, first to sixth.
And we used to go to school every single day back and forth. And I'm so proud that he made it. He made it. And he always comes when his roots are here. And he come from the waters.
Next right here. This how I got that four three four two speed. I used to go in here and like take the fruit snacks, walk in the back, take the fruit snacks, and walk out, and the security used to try to chase me. I don't know what he was doing. I used to just burn out, and Bubba and them, all of them would be standing, they ain't chasing nobody but me. I get all the fruit snacks and go on the block and give everybody the fruit snacks. This is epic right here, bro. I got caught a couple times up there too. Memories. But the best part is coming back to where it all started
and still getting that same love and people remembering and still got stories to tell and still welcome you like you've been here your whole life. I mean, it's gonna be a big part of me because the definition of me came from Gowanus, that mentality. So it's always gonna be something special. And that's why on them courts, I be busting people's ass because there's always the thought of being an underdog. And that's what I took to Robeson for 4 years, then to college, and then after that to the pros with that same mentality.
Attend Robeson because going to my junior high school that I did in Gowanus Project, which is in South Brooklyn, majority of those players that go to Nathan Hale actually goes to New Utrecht for high school. And one day we had a game in the summer at 258, and me and my Uncle Ross.
Again, like, he used to beg all of us to come to his games, and niggas was like, nah, I'm not coming to no fucking game, you ain't shit. I'm definitely not coming to no game. So one time he begged me, like, yo, Unc Dag, nobody come to my game. So I snuck down to 258 and he played. So I'm watching him. I'm like, yo, this little motherfucker is bad. And happened to make it so bad, Mage, God rest his soul, he was reffing the game. So Gary went for like a light 50. And he was like, Mage came up to Gary and said, yo, who you with? He said, yo, I'm with my uncle. So he was like, yo, where Gary live at? I said, Gary's staying in Gowanus. So May said, yo, where Gary live at? So I was like, yo, he stay in Gowanus. He said, no, you don't hear me. Where Gary live at? So I caught it. I said, oh, Gary live on St. Mark's now.
So he was like, I think we should go to Robeson.
He came to the house that night to get Gary in the Robeson. Dude had
like 35, 40.
Like light 50. So when me and G walking home, like, I'm walking in front of him. I'm like, yo, he's really nice. So he was like, yo, Unc, how I play? I played it off. I said, man, you play like shit, my nigga. Like, if you had 50, you could have had 60. Like, so you was bullshitting. He's like, in his head, I was like, he was like, damn, this nigga's really hard on me. So when I got to the crib, I spoke to Mike and Drake. He was in the room. I said, yo, nah, G different, son. Like, G got that. He got it. And then Mage got him in the role, and then that's how the party started.
And realistically, after that, I thought it was a no-brainer. That's where I wanted to go. And ever since then, my eighth grade summer, I would go play with the high school players. I'd go play with the Robeson guys. Me and my other freshman bro, Ante Gates. And I always had a lot of tough love because I'm light-skinned. Coach used to always clown about light-skinned people being soft. So we used to play, and he used to have me standing in the sun while everybody in the shade while we talking and huddling so I could get dark.
Everybody thought it was sweet reading this article, but not really understanding that the trials and tribulations that I had to go through to get to this point right here. playing varsity as a freshman, playing major minutes, and falling off in the middle of my freshman year was probably one of the toughest things I had to deal with. And then it continued on to my sophomore year, not knowing what I'm gonna do, leaving and going to Atlanta.
Then he transferred to Wheeler, got homesick. Yeah, I'm coming back.
And begging my parents to come back to New York, and not being able to play a lot of my sophomore year, really my whole sophomore year, and just focusing on what I can do when it comes to summer basketball. I thought that that was one of the things that made me get to the point to where I felt like I belong, you know, playing with the older guys, with Kenny Kings in Kingston Park, holding my own, taking everything by storm, and entering my junior year where I decided that this is my time now and the wait is really over. And it started in the classroom because I really didn't take that serious, and I actually took it for granted. And that was one of the reasons why I wasn't able to be who I was on the court up until, well, until my senior. One of the real struggles that I had was staying focused in school, you know, because of the hype of being a varsity basketball player as a freshman. And some of those things were, you know, not really doing my homework in school and worrying about, you know, cutting class and being in the hallways. And one of the biggest distractions was the attention that I got from the girls, you know, because I thought that that was, at the time, more important than, you know, doing my schoolwork because I didn't see the bigger picture. And I didn't see it for a while, and that's why I wasn't able to play and get on those courts until my junior and senior year.
His first year failed off. When I say I was on fire, son, I was on. Because he could have dominated for 4 years. He dominated 2 years of high school basketball. If he would have played four, the numbers would have been crazy. Everything would have been crazy. So, but when he fell off, I think I didn't speak to G for like a whole year. Just call my phone, hang up, walk right past him, be in the house, walk right past him.
I'm cutting class, being in the hallway, being in two or three gym periods, you know, trying to play basketball, not understanding how serious it was when it comes to that, because I was just, you know, a freshman, you know, from Crown Heights / Gowanus that just thought that my talents would take me to places that I didn't understand that school would actually be the real reason why I was able to get there.
But Gary did the work in the summertime. I mean, summer school, he was busting his ass.
The end of my sophomore year, going into the summer, is when I started playing unlimited at the age of 16. Had a lot of people that I actually looked up to, and actually gave me insight of to what I didn't want to happen. And one of those people was my big bro, KB, who was just as talented as anybody that ever came out of New York.
I played with a lot of them. Jamal Tinsley, I started off Brooklyn, USA, Ziggy. And from right there, it was just take off. My first day playing out here, first game ever, I had 42. Against the neighborhood best, just by myself. You know, me and Gary played against each other, played against some street ball. First time ever playing here. It was what, 19, what year was that? I've been like 99. He was young, always watching me. His family always was telling him to get at me. I'm like, all right.
Yo, you have to pay attention to KB, and I love KB. I said, KB is the one. So I said, if you're gonna be the king around here, you gotta smoke KB.
And Gary was telling me, I'm gonna get at you. I'm like, all right. Got the best of him that game.
Right.
Got the best of him.
Took KB about 2-3 weeks to killing Gary. I mean, killing him.
Anybody that came in here, they knew they had to see me.
He was it for us. Like, that was our GOAT, still is our GOAT.
So, yeah, I was the GOAT.
KB gave a fuck about you, KB was on you. He wanted you around him, taught you shit, he showed you shit, but it was tough love type shit.
He grew up, played with us up the hill, at the tournament on St. John, on St. Mark's, in Underhill. Played in there, he played behind me, but he always was waiting to go. He was waiting for his turn, His turn came, we played each other in here. 4 years straight, we won it all. Yep, I was backcourt with him.
G took something from every one of us. Every one of us. But her, G was a fucking genius, bro. That nigga took something from every one of us and just accumulated that shit into his game. So as he got older, he just kept fucking getting better at everything that he loved. He got a million influences. I mean, look at his uncles, Dre, Uncle Ant, Uncle Ross.
He helped me realize that even if you don't know which path you want to go, don't go the same route as me. And I thought that was something that kind of flicked the switch in my mind.
Streets caught me and got me. Not going to school, corner. Shot three times.
You know what I'm saying?
Back and forth to jail. A whole lot, man. Alcoholic, a whole bunch. It got me. I used to pray almost every day. Nobody never used to know. Like, wow, you know, one day, man. And it's crazy how I used to like, I wanted to go to jail just to get rid of that. Word. Like, I wanted to, like, tell my man Murder, like, I just can't wait, because I was sentenced, but I had to wait for a day to go in.
Right.
I'm like, yo, when is day gonna hurry up to come? So they came and got me early, like, on the block. So I'm like, you know what? This is it right here. There's no love out here. No love in these streets. No love. No love in these streets. So whatever you're doing, stick with it. Stay motivated. Stay out the way. Stay focused. 7 years clean. That's what it is. I love it, dog. I had my mind set for that too. When I got locked up, that's my main thing I thought. I mean, everybody thought I was gonna come home, I was gonna be drinking and nah, look at me now.
I can't be one of those people that the hood loves, but nothing else comes behind it.
KD was on top of the world. I would have been in the NBA. I knew that. I would have been there. I knew that. Sure. My family, they tell me that to this day. And I look at them like, they tell me that to this day. I'm like, wow. So I knew what I had.
Let's play 5 against 1. Yo, man, yo, don't do that, yo, because if he trying to play you,
yeah, seriously.
Now I'm like, I gotta go 50 foot. Oh, where Kobe at, baby?
So, this is when shit got real. Going into my senior year, the summer of my senior year that was, and preparing for ABCD camp, you hear about it, you see the top players in the country. You know, from the previous years, the guys that's in the NBA, they show their highlights from ABCD camp. And I didn't know what to expect, but I just knew that I was ready for it, and it was my time to be able to showcase my talent on the big stage to show that I belong. And with flying colors from the start of ABCD camp, you know, the best players are second and fourth quarter, and then the bench players usually go second and third. I mean, obviously I was in the second quarter, but they already disrespected me by putting me in the group that was based on, you know, two guards and centers and small forwards, not the group where they had all of the point guards that was supposed to be quote unquote the top players in the country at that time at every position, I mean from every class. But
I killed it. We won the championship. Well, we won the championship. I had one of my brothers play with me, Lenny Cook, which was dope, but it's a few games that I really remember. You know, one was playing against Allen Ray and Kurt Stinson.
Gary versus Allen Ray. Please don't get it twisted. I love Allen Ray too, but Allen Ray was the top dog coming to the senior year.
Allen Ray was ranked high in New York City, and we could never play against each other. It was always, you know, Catholic school versus public school. It wasn't no real wars. Nobody was hunting each other, but we got a chance to play against each other. And that right there was the start of, you know, just me being able to showcase my talent, and we beat them. And I cooked like I was supposed to.
We caught his ass at ABCD camp.
And from then on, you know, it was a different person. But it's always the biggest when adversity hit.
Let me tell you about the politics of the ABCD camp. Gary DeCesar and Gary Charles did some fuck shit to G. Gary dominated the whole camp. Did not make the All-Star game. It was me and my brother Dre. Was Mike there? Yeah, it was all of us. So Gary was like, yo, take me home, man. I'm not making the All-Star game. I said, gee, you gotta make the All-Star. Yeah, you dominated in here.
Remember like it was yesterday. We was in the elevator and we was going up to my room with Uncle Mike, Reese, and Ross. And I was like, yo, let's break out, man. Let's leave. Let's pack our stuff. We can leave tonight. They're not gonna let me make this team. They're not. I'm telling you, they're gonna jerk me. And I already felt it, and I knew why. It's because I wasn't playing with Adidas team no more, and I went to Nike. But, you know, at some point as a young man, you do know that, you know, you think that when your games show, this is things that happen. But at the end of the day, you know, adversity hit, and it made me a bigger person.
I was on another level. Anybody that know, if I start up the game and I hit a corner three, it's gonna be a long, long night. And they was just chanting that they wanted Robeson, they wanted Gary Ervin. It's just like, just be careful for what you wish for.
Worked hard, man, just going in the basement, running, weights in our hand, running up the steps, running down the steps, four flights, like every day. We wouldn't leave Robeson until like, shit, and at 8 o'clock at night. And we probably start practice like at 4, or after study hall. So, yeah, we put some work in, it was a lot of work. People see like all the glamorous stuff, like when we playing, and when he's just jumping and dunking on everybody. Or we just steal them everybody. Or we put a lot of work in there. So, you know, the only thing that happened was the hard work just paid off. That scene. I had sprained my ankle. He just came up to me, he's like, don't worry about it, I got it. I'm gonna take it over. And then exactly what he did, he just started just scoring crazy. Like when he get them scoring bursts, it was unbelievable. It was just something you wouldn't even really, like when you see it now on camera, you just be like, wow.
Game, I didn't even know this fool had that many points because I'm watching the game And I'm hyped, you know, I'm all over the place. Talking mad shit, cursing the refs out. Like, we was threatening the refs, all type of shit. And he just kept scoring and scoring. I was like, yo, this motherfucker's going crazy. Him and Rob Wright. Give props to Rob Wright, too. Rob Wright went to work that game. But G was just on another level, stopping and pulling up from three-point range, laying it up, running like he went dog shit in that game. And we was driving home. They lost that game. We was driving home. He was like, yo, you know, I just had da-da-da, like 30-something in 2 minutes. So, man, you bumped your whole motherfucking head. So when the next day I look in the paper and what's the lady name? Christy Atkin was the reporter for the Daily News. And she wrote that shit. I said, oh, this little motherfucker went ham. Like, he went dog shit. Like, he was on one that night. They happened to lose by like 5. Good game.
I started feeling like I couldn't be guarded, you know, and it didn't matter who was in front of me. I thought that I was faster, I was better, I was stronger, I was more athletic, and I would use that to my advantage.
He left it on the court that day, man. When I say he left that shit on the court, he left it on the court that day. He went dog shit that day.
Lincoln Road, I mean, best two teams in the city. You got two Afro-American guys at the helm. Majors, may he rest in peace. You know, we all know how he was rolling that robe. Of course, Tiny's rolling at Lincoln. You got Sebastian Telfair. You got G. Earp, best two guards in the city, bar none. And we had to play each other every now and then. And there would be wars. And I remember the time when Tiny decided to pull a team off the court. And it was like really chippy. I don't know if it was to the point that someone would get hurt, but to Tiny's thinking, it didn't make sense for us to continue because he didn't want to risk an injury. But so we just, you know, wound up playing them, not finishing that game. And I think they got upset in the playoffs, so they didn't make it back. But I mean, it was just a robbery. You know, you got Coney Island, you got Bed-Stuy, you know, two teams. And like I said, two best guards. And there was no one in there, two guys class, you know. And it was just, it's crazy. That was, those games would be crazy.
In all reality, we already know what it really is. And what people know when it comes to high school basketball in my era is Gary Ervin and Sebastian Telfair. I mean, that's all everybody know. You know, we could talk about everything else, but that was it. So, my junior year semifinals, we played at St. John's versus the Lincoln Rail Spitters. It was Sebastian freshman year, and he was on the other side of Brooklyn, and he was killing. He was a nationally known young phenom, you know, at that time, which was a little brother to me.
The rivalry between him and Bashy, make it so funny, Bashy is just like his best friend too, though. Like, he used to come to the house, spend the night. Gary used to go out there in Coney Island and fuck with him.
And nobody really understood that, but you know how it is in New York. It's easy to make somebody your rival.
The media tried to play them against each other, like, yo, he the number one dog. And I was kind of like the fucking mad scientist behind that shit too. Like, son, this is the motherfucker that we gotta get. We cannot be cool with this dude. So at the end of the day, we gotta get in his ass. Like, we gotta, like, he got the shit that we want. So we was Death Row Records and they was Bad Boys. They was getting all the pub and we was like, yo, listen, man, G gotta get.
So that first game, the first time we ever played against each other on that stage, was at St. John's, and at that time we had a better team, and I think we won by like 20. I had like 27, I think he had like 25 or something like that. But that was the start of a New York City rival that only people that played the game of basketball could ever be on a stage like that, on a rival like that, with two of the top guards in New York, to me, in history.
That rivalry, that was one of the best, and I've been around ball for a long time. That was one of the top battles I've ever seen.
Is he going to need to get his 30 for you to win this game?
I think Gary's type of kid, he'll do whatever necessary for us to win, whether it's points, whether it's rebounding, whether it's assists. So we don't exactly look to him for points, but like he did against, you know, Canarsie, even though we lost the game, he scored 30 points in the fourth quarter. He could get it done.
And this is a game that's going to the final horn, and you would expect a close game. Are your guys ready? Is that whole January 5th thing behind you and your program?
Oh, definitely. I mean, that wasn't even a game that's supposed to count. This game counts for the city championships.
Great players, both schools playing very well as they get to the championship game. Both have outstanding star types to be on the floor here.
No question about it. And I'll tell you what, it's perfect that you have two teams from Brooklyn here, because New York City basketball, the BSAL, is played in Brooklyn. All four city semifinalists from the borough of Brooklyn, when you throw in boys and girls, and last year's defending champ, Grady High School.
And here's our famous arena. Today's second game is for the Boys A Championship of the PSA Rail Splitters of Abraham Lincoln High School and the Eagles of Paul Robeson High School. Let's see the Baskin Telfair. The assistant coaches are Kwame Morton, Colin Green, and Danny.
Now you get to the Garden, and the lights is on, and, you know, every team got to make adjustments, and they wound up getting the best of us, you know. It wasn't our night that night, and I remember it, you know. I mean, obviously, because the heartache and pain, you know, the crying, the hard work, you know, dedication we put into a season to be number one throughout the year, and then to lose. You know, the most important game of the season.
Share the moment.
The biggest thing was uncertainty. At Robeson, you know, being prideful, you know, bullshitting in school, not being eligible for a year and a half out of my first 2 years was a struggle, because I didn't really think that I would do what I love, and that's playing basketball, because academics wasn't really important to me. Or must I say, I didn't take it serious. And I thought that you can do that without, you know, I could play basketball without taking that serious. And it was a, you know, a rude awakening, really. And it was an eye-opener. On the court stuff, my junior year went great, but it was a cloud over my head as far as, you know, do I take the SAT, do I take the ACT, you know, what's gonna happen next? I mean, it wasn't really too much a panic, but at the end of the day, you know, you got a talent, and because of not taking school seriously, you know, the first 2 years, it put me in a place where I had to dig deep in order to succeed at it. And it didn't take until me getting college letters and coaches asking Coach Mage, you know, about school and eligibility and all that. And I had all of the schools, but I didn't have the score. Not that I couldn't do it, it's just that I had a lot of work to do. So really didn't know if I was gonna go D1 or was junior college, you know, part of it. Didn't really know too much about that. It was just more that what's next. And everything went great as far as that up until going to prep school. And I was able to get it done. And after that, you know, it was back to business. Then once I got to college, you know, obviously I chose Mississippi State, you know, because they was loyal at the time and I was being loyal to them. And, you know, I was one of the top guards in the country and, you know, for sure I thought I was going to college and I was starting and it didn't happen. You know, it was promised, but it didn't happen. And it kind of, you know, put me in the place of like, damn, you know, they lied to me, you know. But at the end of the day, I kept grinding and my first year came off the bench, but I actually played well. We won SEC, so that was the big thing about it. But then after that, my sophomore year is when adversity, you know, struck. And at this time, it struck real hard because we was top 15 in the country. I'm the starting point guard. And I just felt that, you know, sometimes coaches recruit you for what they want you to be and not for what you are. And I got caught up in that and I got away from, you know, being the person that I was, you know, to get recruited and to be the top, you know, in the country. So I had an up and down sophomore year. It was solid, you know, I had some really big games. But I think the turning point was against LSU at home. I kind of got benched for something and I let my emotions get the best of me and I walked out of the end of game meeting. I mean, but at that time I really felt that I was going to transfer because, you know, I felt like I was getting toyed with. It was an up and down situation and I needed a new beginning. So it was already going to be that. So I finished out my sophomore year strong. And this picture is dope. It's just a coincidence that Naj got my Mississippi State jersey. But at one point after he passed, I just thought about giving up. But the real reason I didn't give up because that's not what he wanted for me. And he was one of my biggest supporters. He was one of the people that always believed in me. And on the flip side, I had to live the dream of both of us because anybody that know Naj, he was a genuine person, but out of all of us that was playing together, he probably had the best skill set. He had the total package. He could shoot from deep. He had good size. He could handle the basketball. He could rebound and push. That's something that a lot of us couldn't do growing up. And I remember the day that it happened. I was driving from practice. At my first practice at Arkansas, we had 2-a-days. And I was driving home and Todd called me crying, like, Naj passed. And like I couldn't believe it, I was shocked. And I was just driving home crying, thinking about it. You know, I got home and
I bust through the door, I ran in my room, I started crying. My mom was up there, my daughter's mom was there, and you know, I had to explain to them what happened. And it really it left a sour taste in my mouth for the fact that he was supposed to leave days before Labor Day to come with me to Arkansas, because he was living with me at the time. At that time, I didn't know what to do. I never lost nobody really, really close to me, so I didn't know how to react and bounce back. I kind of told my mom and people close, you know, that I don't know if I want to play basketball, you know, because this was something that it hit home. But then as, you know, time started to go by, I went back to Arkansas. I was like, I gotta do it for Naj. Just through the grace of God and thinking about Naj, that was the only way I was able to get through.
You know, it's so funny too, like, and I learned this through pain and years, it took a long time. But I still go see him anytime when I feel like it. Shit, just like, to me, Naj is light. Like, it took me a long time just to realize Naj is light. Naj came to do what he came to do, and it was just time for him to leave. It's just the finality of death is what really shocks us when you really think about it. The people who Naj bring together. I can name at least 7 people off the top of my head that has Naj tattoo on their body. People from different blocks, from different walks of life. Naj just connected everybody. So it's like, that's why I was able to start pushing past it, is because he's light. So there's no way you can match lightning, light with darkness. You know what I'm saying? So every time I think of Naj now, instead of crying or instead of drinking, I just smile. I just laugh. I'm thinking of the dumb shit he used to do. Like, you know what I mean? And it's just, Naj is light. That's just what it is, man. Naj is light.
Yo, my brother, I just want to tell you thank you for being a big brother, for being one of my biggest supporters, and for letting me continue to live my dream through your spirit. It's not a day that goes by that I don't think about you, and it's not a time that goes by that I don't go check on mom to just understand that she still got another son, you know, that's still here and that's gonna make sure she good. You know, went to Arkansas, new beginning, things went really well. SEC, made it to SEC championship 2 years in a row back to back. But then bam, right after that, you know, I had to see where my toughness at, see where my will was at, see where my hard work was at, because everybody's goal is to get to the NBA, and, you know, I had to go a full circle, D-League, you know, undrafted, you know, which I knew I was going to get, I wasn't going to get drafted, you know, because of, you know, switching my game up, whatever it is, you know, but that was kind of tough.
you know, going from one G League team to the next, playing well, but really not getting that recognition, you know. So I think that the biggest thing from that was the next step was overseas.
After that, I decided that the NBA wasn't important, you know. Basically, it was about, you know, feeding my family and, you know, and doing what I love to do at this point. So right before I decided to go overseas, you know, I got a call from Strip, like, yo, young fella, you know, I want you to do me a favor. I'm trying to become a head coach. You know, I need you to come out there to Canada, even if you come for a little while. So I'm like, all right, cool. All the guys from New York is there. And I went out there, you know, coach fell in love with me. You know, I'm balling, playing real well. Not saying it was easy, but it was kind of almost a breeze just from the fact of, you know, my confidence was high again. I didn't feel like, you know, the ropes was on. It was a new beginning. You know, that scoring and killing mentality came back that nobody could guard me. And I approved it, you know. So we started winning basketball games. My backcourt mate at the time, Tony Bennett from Chicago, was super tough, you know. So I definitely got to show love to him. But, you know, played well. I think we made it to the finals or semifinals. I think it was the finals. And lost in the championship to Michael Ray Richardson team, who had a former Arkansas Razorback on that team as well. But, you know, wind up, you know, having a great season, you know, had about 5 triple-doubles or something like that. Wound up making an all-star game, got MVP of the all-star game. Was running up in a dunk contest, which I'm still mad about to this day, that this is the only dunk contest I was in, and had the basically the trophy in my hand and missed my signature off the backboard dunk, but that's, you know, that's history. Then after that, it was season over, came back home, played in Fireball, you know, was still preparing to see what's next. You know, I knew I was going to get calls to, you know, obviously to go overseas, you know, to Europe, but just weighing my options. And we was playing in, like, West Forth. This is, like, probably one of the dopest stories. We was playing in West Forth. Actually, we was playing in Pro City, and I think I had, like 40 or something. And then like the next day or two, we had to play in West Forth. And when we played in West Forth, I want to say, no lie, I think it was against Sean Bell. And I know I had like 48 or 50 in that game, if I'm not mistaken. And after the game, some guy came up to me and was like, hey, this is some guy, information, he's a scout, he coached in China, and he's from Australia, and he wanted you to, you know, to please give him a call because he loved your game. And I was like, okay, that's dope. So I wound up getting the information, and I just reached out to the guy, and we were talking, and he's like, you know, he's the head coach in China, and that he loved my game, and that they was looking for a point guard in Australia, you know, at Willagong. And obviously from there, the rest is history, you know, wound up seeing me. And in the next month or two, I was on my way to Australia, you know, for the first time ever, which I thought was so dope.
Joined by the new Hawks import, Gary Ervin. How are you, mate?
I'm doing really well today.
Welcome to the Gong.
Yeah, I'm happy to be here.
Now, you come from New York, you wouldn't see many views like this behind us, would you, in New York?
Oh, not at all. I don't know when the last time I actually been to the beach, you know, so it's kind of different, you know, but it's beautiful.
Well, first day of spring today, summer's just around the corner. Do you reckon you'll find most of your spare time at the beach down here at the Gong?
Oh, yeah, I'm going to try. You know, a couple of the guys have been, you know, having a little jokes about being out there, about the sharks and stuff, and being sharks, you know, just joking around, but I'm excited about it, and it's a beautiful place.
And now you've been to training now for the past 5 days or so. How do you like getting along with the team and playing down here so far?
Oh, it's great. You know, a great group of guys, versatile, you know, a lot of bigs that can shoot, you know, so it's going to open up a lot for me to, you know, attack and play my game, get them the basketball in, you know, easy positions for them to score.
Boy, you on the track.
able to hit some big threes from downtown.
Sure was, and when he's mixing it up like that, you've got to get up on him. And him showing his strength there, he's able to kiss one off the backboard. His strength, once he gets into the paint, he can finish or he can find a target like big Luke Neville. He's so quick and explosive, he's just a nightmare to stop when he is getting the basketball to his teammates.
Yeah, definitely. You can see with this talent
here why he won the MVP a couple of years ago.
And it's one of the go-to players in the NBL at the moment and has to be ranked right up there with Cedric Jackson.
I never thought about my life after my playing days. But I do remember, you know, a time when I was in college and my college coach, Stan, he told me that I would be a coach when basketball is all said and done. And I was telling him, nah, coach, I don't think that's me. And I mean, obviously, that's from just realizing that, you know, my mind was focused on, you know, now and not really the future. But now look at me. I'm a coach. I love it. And it's actually stopped me from wanting to play the game of basketball so much, because now I feel like teaching the game is just as fun as playing.
You Steph Curry? Are you Steph Curry? Repeat, what's up?
I remember also another story when how it really happened for me, or just to get on that totem pole of just coaching, was Tiny talking to me about AAU basketball, how I ever thought about coaching. And I told him, not really, you know, because I was still playing in the summer. And he just told me, like, you know, just try it to see, because, you know, these kids need to hear a voice. You know, you've done a lot of things that not a lot of guys were able to accomplish, and that you still can relate because you can play and practice something that a lot of people can't do. And really, from that day on, is where I just turned the tables and said, you know, obviously basketball, you know, has done great for me. I've been, you know, to 10, 11 countries. I was able to provide for my family.
You got to be able to walk the walk and talk the talk, and he walked it. So he's going to be a great father figure to the young men, a great ambassador to the game. Like, you don't get it all in one. He played, now he coaching. So that's like a cheat code because he know what he did, and he helping other young black men, and that's what it's all about, just helping and giving back to the kids that look like you, man.
You know, the list goes on, but in all reality, the basketball doesn't bounce forever. It is what can you do to touch other people's lives, and I think that me coaching was the easiest way to continue to do what I love, but to obviously change lives for these kids that don't know what it takes, and to just watch it and think that you can just roll over out your bed and you're a Division I basketball player or a student athlete, not understanding the hard work and dedication that come with it, the ups and downs and, you know, the doubters and the people that believe in you. It's a lot of trials and tribulations when it comes to that, but, you know, I think that that's my sole purpose, you know, at the end of the day, is to be a coach and to give these guys the gems and the knowledge of everything that I've been through to see if they can get past, you know, the bumps and bruises that I had to go through.
Gary Ervin is misunderstood. I feel like I've come to realize that when you chase and achieve a certain level of greatness, it comes with a certain level of what people might consider selfishness or self-centeredness, but it's actually focus on what you're trying to do. And if you don't have the right people around you, you'll actually crash and burn because they won't understand it and they'll end up derailing you. Gary Ervin is loving. He's actually a very cool and loving individual if you actually get to know him, which is why I say he's misunderstood, because a lot of times you hear, yo, your brother's conceited, your brother's cocky, your brother thinks he's better than everybody, and it's like, have you even really had a conversation of, like, please don't confuse what happens on a basketball court for 32 or 48 minutes with who a person actually is. Like, that's not him. That's just the competitor in him to want to win and prove that I'm really better than you, and I don't really want this to be debatable. Gary Ervin is inspiration. Gary Ervin is hope for every little kid in the inner city with a dream. Gary Ervin is proof that if you have a dream and you stay focused and you also surround yourself with the right people, you can accomplish anything you want to accomplish. Gary Ervin is... Gary Ervin is just proof that anything really is possible. Like, you can come from whatever people want to think you come from, and you can turn your life into something beautiful. Like, you can really come from the mud and then and turn into a really beautiful flower.
The best memories I have that are close to my heart is, you know, finally having a child, because it taught me how to be an adult at an early age, because I had someone that was going to depend on me no matter what the circumstances were. And my daughter Nevaeh actually made it a lot easier for me too. You know, while in college, I'm having rough days, but, you know, going home to my daughter who, you know, doesn't know anything, but, you know, to see her dad as a superhero. So that's one of the memories that will always stick out in my mind. And, you know, a few years after that, having my son, you know, everybody wants that chance to have a mini-me or a junior. And that's going to be able to follow the footsteps, you know, of their parent. You know, so having them being able to, you know, come to Australia, you know, at the age of one, to get those experiences, you know, it's something that I cherish forever. And, you know, I just want them to know I'm always have their back, and because of them, they made me who I am, you know, as a father, as a person, you know, that needed to provide for them, you know, to make their lives a little bit better.
Sunshine. 2020 2021 finalists. Most outstanding player for the finals. Gary Ervin, we match the Earth. Let's climb up to the Earth. He took it left it on the court. He left it out on the court. Where's the Earth? You deserve it, my brother. For real.